Everybody in this world is a genius. But if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, the fish will live its whole life believing that it is not worth anything. A very good afternoon to one and all present here. I, Shraddha Rao, a student manager of Balaji Institute of Modern Management, feel privileged to welcome Mr. Rajan, the Chief Human Resource Officer, Exide Industries Limited. For more than six decades, Exide has been one of India's most reliable brands, enjoying unrivaled reputation and recall. The consistent emphasis on innovation, extensive geographic footprint, strong relationship with clients, and steady technology upgradations have made Exide Industries a distinct front runner. To know more, we have with us a dynamic personality, Mr. Rajan, the Chief Human Resource Officer for Exide Industries Limited. The ladder of success is best climbed by stepping on the rungs of opportunities. So did Mr. Sarkar. Mr. Sarkar completed his MBA, majoring in HR, from Symbiosis Institute of Business Management, Pune. He began his career as a manager HR in GlaxoSmith. Then, as an Assistant Vice President HR in Z Telefilms Limited. Further moving upward as the Deputy Vice President HR in Dish TV India Limited. Then, as an Associate Vice President in Kotak Mahindra Old Mutual Life Insurance Limited. Later, becoming the Vice President HR of CIT Limited. And now, currently assigned as the CHRO for Exide Industry. So student managers, give a huge round of applause as I call upon Mr. Rajan Sarkar and request him to speak a few words about his endeavors and his life experiences.
Good afternoon. You can, no need to say sir again and again. I feel a little intimidated. This is my third visit to your campus, and I always enjoy to come to Balaji again and again. I have a lot of respect for your dean here. I think that the gentleman has, Professor Bala, has made it quite big as an academician. And personally, I don't like to stand there, so I'll keep walking, okay? Personally, I like to interact with a lot of young people, which I do in my social life as well as professional life as well, and I always, if some institute calls me, I feel privileged to come and interact. When I was a student in SIBM, the sound is clear, it's echoing. Okay, so sometimes, we are pulled into conferences and made to sit the whole day, and sometimes we used to get very bored. Very frankly, I'm just sharing. So it's my job as well that when you are investing this much time in sitting across various presentations, I will try to also see you in this next 45 minutes if I can add some value to you. I'll try to talk to you in the language you will understand, and we can reciprocate by talking to each other. Okay. I don't normally make very standard slides of a lot of management jargons to really talk to people. And I think the communication becomes easy when it is, so I've got only some pictures to show you, not really too much of slides of text to talk about, because it's difficult through a whole day to sit through. But you know, now I realize why college makes you sit through the whole day. Because when you join work, we also sit through boring meetings the whole day. So you get a practice in college. Okay. So yeah, the subject I think Shraddha or somebody told me about is today's, I think the theme of this seminar is, this is first year or second year? Both, okay. So the second year will perhaps find it a little more relevant. The theme is about the future and the business environment and things like that. And it's global, okay? So I'll talk a little bit of global. All of you have grown up seeing a fantastic series of advertisement of Amul. Have you seen? Every current affairs that come up, they have a kind of a what? Brand mascot. Yeah, they have a, that Adli Badli or something, that brand mascot. But what they pick up, very catchy lines. And if you see it, you don't. Nobody has to explain that to you. You can understand what they're talking about, which big event they're talking about, which subject. Okay. So with their permission, I have borrowed some of their slides to put across my message to you of what I'm going to talk about. Fine. So now let's talk something, because it has to be something that I have to, you know, I have to contribute to this seminar. So the slide is here. Okay. I can read from it. See, can you, there's something unusual about this world map. What is that? See, I don't have too many slides, as I told you. I need a little more response. And yeah. East is on west. Okay. I feel that next 10 years down the line, this will be the world map in the geography books of this country, of the world. You know why? Earlier, the Europe was in the center of the world map. Because you know that the entire invention, the colonization, if you have read history in your school, it's all started from British. And a large part of before US and other countries developed, US was the ruler of the world, the Roman Empire and all those things, right? But I think now I think Asia will be in the middle of the world map. That's how the globe will be, and the international trade will not be Atlantic. It will be Pacific in future. Because that's where the powers will, China, Southeast Asia, India, US of course, some part of Brazil, and Northern Japan, Korea of course, that will be the torque of this world. So on a seminar like this, I wanted to start off by saying that I feel that this will be, you know, indicatively, not like the new world map that's going to come. That's where the powers will center. So so taking from there, what's happening? If you see some of the changes that are happening in the world, which people are talking about, there's nothing new, perhaps I will say, but I will try to tell it in my way. Because everybody will talk about technology, everybody will talk about everything, but I'll try to have my interpretation to some of these things. So I'll talk about a few slides about that. What does this mean? See, all of you are into academics, right? Do you know I read somewhere from some very person of high wisdom how the education world has evolved. Long back, there used to be Gurukul system. In India, I don't know about the other parts of the world. Then the concept of university started. Okay. Then the world moved to having universities all around. Then there was a big pull off before Balaji and everything came in management. 30 years back, the wave of management was not there. It was more about technical education. So India saw a huge amount of, I'm referring India because I know about only this country's education history. There's a huge plethora of technical institutes that came up. All, a lot of entrepreneurs started engineering colleges, engineering everywhere. Last 15, 20 years, the whole education pool is about management, right? You know, business management, travel management, hotel management, energy management. It's the world of management, because from technical, the world is moving towards general management education. I have a belief that in the next 10 years, the next wave that will come after MBAs will be communication management. That's my belief in the education. And that is reflected because what happens in the world, the education system follows to provide supply of that students to the world, to that economics. So I have a feeling that I guess in the country, in India today, there is only one country that is Mica, which is Mudra, which is specializing in communication. But I think that's another generation of education that will come, because the world is becoming about communication. So as I said, it's the same thing I'm going to talk to you about, but in my own interpretation. From politics to everywhere, I don't know whether you can read what is there in the red patch. It's called management, you can read. By communication, okay? And it is management by communication, it is not a very general skills. It will become a science. I'm standing and talking to all of you. Do you know when politicians make speeches, they are trained to do so. They don't do naturally. Now, that is only oral communication. Then there are written communication, indirect communication, mass communication, social communication, one-to-one communication. Communication is something that will drive perception, that will drive emotion. And that is going to be one of the key changes in this world around every facets of our life. That's one big change which will also affect business, coming back to the subject of today's seminar. Fair? That's, you can challenge. I'm not saying what I say is what I believe. I have a right to my opinion. You have a right to your opinion as well. And you can discuss and cross-question if you want. What does this mean? You know this movie, right? So it talks about what is written in red here is free transaction and collaboration versus, meaning there is a one set of people that will talk about free movement of goods, capital, people, sorry. Yeah, FDI is money. So what can move? Money can move. Goods can move. Import, export, people can move. So there'll be a certain sections in this world which will talk about movement of goods, services, and this thing. They will encourage it. Who will encourage it? Those who will benefit it. Because nothing in this world is always a win-win. There is always some parties in any transaction which wins, even in our day-to-day lives, even at home. Okay, it's always a transaction. It will move. But there will be equally opposing forces who would be, like, for example, within this room, we hear about a lot of restrictive practices Donald Trump is building. Why is he doing something? I'm not saying right or wrong. Okay, I'm nobody to judge that. But he's doing it for protecting certain corners, that you are already convinced. Okay, good. So he will take you very easily, he'll give you a green card. So yes, if I look at it, there are certain fundamentalism in him who is looking at certain things which is good for the country. Why not? If our prime minister can tell that make in India everything, why can't he as his president of the country tell why? There's nothing wrong in that. But I'm saying, but he will, so what he's doing, he's reading, I don't know, I'm sure he must be, as a management student, you must be reading a lot of stuff around the world, what's happening news. You know that there is something called this NAFTA agreement, there is this NATO agreement, which he's renegotiating, because he is saying that in the openness, we lost us, so he's making restrictive policies. So the world will be like this. It will be very volatile both ways. There will be pressure groups who will talk about opening up free transaction collaboration versus close. Now let me, I'll make this example to make it a little more realistic in your own life. Suppose, don't take it seriously, just a joke, okay? Suppose there is a Balaji Telecom Institute, which is doing very well. And let's say Balaji HRM is not doing so well. So one thought is you collaborate study materials, campus programs, so that both the institute win for each other. If this is not, this is just a hypothetical, okay? Just to give an example. But suppose the telecom fields, no, I want to be the best. There's a competition that comes, that I don't want to collaborate. So both feelings can come. So in the world, we'll have both such phenomena. Okay, that's what is happening, and that will happen. There is also a prediction that a lot of very communal leaders will come. Communal in a sense, like example, Obama was a very liberal leader. He didn't stand for a particular community or something. But world is turning such that the leaders are becoming very strong in their own pockets by having a lot of communal support. Hence, they will be protective. So both the phenomena, okay? So I don't think the entire, you know, we have a scare and fear. Everything in this world will be digitalized. Okay, at least some people believe that. Some people believe that everything will be brick and mortar. I believe that it will be a mix of both. I was talking to the corporate, the dossier that you publish here. And you're asking me about automation, I don't know the gentleman's name, but upstairs. Yeah. So he was talking to me about digitalization. I said, okay, so much halla gulla about Amazon and e-commerce and all that. The last known figure to me, few months back, e-commerce percentage of India is how much, you know? When all this mantra and all this thing came in, people thought, okay, all shops will close. They'll all buy online. But you know what is the percentage? Huh? 3% is the e-commerce percentage in India. Last known figure, it might have gone by 1 or 2% more now. Please don't judge India by what you do in the city of Pune or in your own life. You are just 0.00001%. Okay? It's only that much. It doesn't mean that the local, you don't order your cigarettes. You just walk down and buy stuff. There'll be still shops around the corner. There'll be still hard. Still a physical world, there will be still a brick and mortar thing, not only in India, in most countries, okay? What will happen will be a synapse. Synapse means where the digital and the physical worlds interact. You know, that's what is called a synapse. And that word is given a rise to something called IoT, Internet of Things. Synapse is, there'll be a physical thing, but if I'm drinking the water, there'll be certain, that action of physical will have some data transmission or something which will give me some output. That's a physical and digital synapse will happen across many places. That will improve the efficiency, that will help life being better, but I don't think suddenly everything will change from physical to digital. In this new world, we're talking about what are the emerging trends in the world, it's about a lot will happen in the space about complex relationships. Okay? This is just an example. So this gentleman married a very contemporary UK citizen. Then he married a lady of his own religion, and then he married a very, very, you know that, right? Okay, so what I'm saying, showing this to you is because it's going to be managing very complex relationships, okay? The defined relationships that we had, a very stable social structure that we have, because no seminar, on business or even corporate for that matter, exists without discussing our life, our social life. Okay, corporate is just part of it. We think it's very big, it's nothing, it's just part of it. It's a part of a bigger society. Okay? many, if you have gone all the second years, if you have gone for summer training, you must have seen in many of your companies, people are talking about diversity, diversity. Have you heard? Anybody talked about that? I don't know if you have a seminar on all these inclusion and D&I. Diversity cannot come into corporate world unless it comes into the social world. Okay? Stuff like that. People are talking how many women are working in the workplace. Nobody is asking how many men is helping at home. You know? So diversity has to come in the as a social problem. It's not a corporate problem. So similarly, you'll find the world, similarly in the business environment, we have a link to the social environment. And it's my own judgment that relationships in the world, whether it is a partner relationship, whether it is a professional relationship, whether it is mentor prodigy, whether it is business relationship for the matter, business, those relationships will be very complex. And one need to live and understand and accept that it will be like that. If you feel that it's not like that, you will only hurt yourself. It is going to be like that. And one has to live in that with that ability to handle complex relationships and break up of relationships. Okay. Because this social pattern is going to affect our way our business lives also. I'm talking about, ma'am, I'm just taking the liberty of talking about a broader context in the business. Yeah? This man represents a very volatile life. Okay? Right? In the movie, he has done so much ups and downs in life. So imagine the world is the life of this man. How it will be? So there'll be emotions, drama, ups, downs. You all hear about volatility, complexity, and all the stuff, the VUCA world. I think this represents that. So I'm using some pictorial metaphors because that helps you to associate. The image helps you to associate. So you know, Sanjay, that's life, world aisa hai. Ho jayega, it's easy. Now you know how to deal with the VUCA world. So it's, but it'll go on. The message here is the man didn't die. The world will go on, will go through these transitions, but it will go on. It is expected that by 2030, almost 50% to 60% of the population of this world will move to cities and will clog cities. Another by 2040, perhaps 70-75%. Agricultural economy is going to get more automated. I think 2 or 3 days back, I read in the newspaper somebody in Netherlands, some scientist has developed a meat burger in the lab. So good, you don't need to grow. So supplements to food, built in lab, and all these things are a little distant, but it'll come up. It's not going to be an unreality, it'll be a reality. The agriculture economy will slowly move towards industrial economy and digital economy, and people will move towards. Now, why am I telling you this? Because that also affects business world. That also affects as you become, you know, business leaders in various companies. How do you make strategies? Because these are the things that are the trends, the social trends you need to know. Management, as a management person, we are all also social human beings. And it's not important to only read management books, but to understand sociology and what's happening around. Then you make good decisions. But this is another big trend that the world will see. We are very happy with so much of connectedness, right? Around everything, information flow, WhatsApp, you know, Facebook is connected, Instagram kar diya, wo kar diya, all the information flowing, sharing. She's nodding. She's agreeing or disagreeing? Agreeing? Okay. But it will also have a lot of invasion of your privacy. And there will be a lot of, and the legal world, I'm not sure is ready today to handle this kind of, this kind of digital world invasion of privacy. For example, in my 5 years back when I was in HR of a company, there was no policy called Nobody ever thought of a policy called social media policy. Now companies are forced to have a policy called social media policy. Why? Because a new world needs a governance, right? So I'll just demonstrate to you now. I'll just take 5 minutes of humor because everybody is a little tired of my of my presentation, perhaps. So I will try to. No. No. So I will use a. So just a little humor on how it is invading our. I'll just give a demonstration. Okay. Okay. So this is the city of Pune. This is good luck. Everybody knows good luck. So imagine a few years down the line. So a customer calls up good luck. Okay, hello, good luck, cafe. The answer. Yes, Mr. Sharma. Can you read?
Yes, sir.
How do you know my name? Your number is registered. Would you order the usual? He's asking. What is usual? Sir, 4 times of last 6 times you ordered chicken biryani. He's replying. How do you know that? Sir, your order history is in my cloud. No. I want 6 plates of keema pav this time. Sir, keema is mutton and you have high cholesterol. Good luck is telling you. Okay. How do you know that? Sir, your credit card number has medical history linked to it, which says that you have history of cholesterol. Don't worry. My health is fine now. Thank you. The customer is saying. But sir, you went for a blood test last week and the cholesterol showed high. Okay. I just read it step by step. You go step by step. Oh God, how do you know so much? Are you stalking me? No, sir. You posted a pic in Facebook and shared with your friends. It's captured in a KYC search engine analytics. You mean your analytics can read my private posts? Sir, we pay a subscription for big data. Also, your credit history showed a payment of Rs. 650 to Fortis Clinic in Baner on 23rd August. If I got the spelling wrong, sorry. Fortis OPD red chart shows blood test at 650. See the interconnectedness of information, see how it works and how it might work. You close your restaurant and start an investigation agency. I don't want your keema pav. Don't be angry, sir. I'm trained to answer your questions using a logic-based algorithm. Why do you need algorithm to talk? Can't you talk to me using your brain? I don't have a brain. I only have a microprocessor. You're crazy. I'll complain against you. What's your name? Sir, I don't have a name. My machine code is chatbox 6.2. Oh God, so long I was talking to a nobody. Okay, please send me 6 plates keema pav and no more questions. Sir, I assume you'll pay by card or online as you may not have enough cash. Now, how you can predict that also? Sir, your bank transaction does not have any visit to ATM for the last 2 months. He's using algorithm. Shit, I don't want anything. I will run away from this country. Sir, you can't, as your passport will expire in 3 months and no valid visa. Okay, so this is just a small demonstration just to talk to you about interconnectedness, good or bad, I don't know. you can judge yourself. But just to show how the information, the world of information and data, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
How it's going to affect, just I just thought I'll put up in the form of a question answer for you to feel about it. Now you decide you're feeling angry or happy, it's your decision. Coming to the future of, since we're talking about business, I also wanted to show you some trends about which industry the job creation will happen, which industry is going to have the primary industries for the future. Now, this is here, I'm not using my judgment. I have been lucky to interact with a person in Bangalore called Mr. Anton. Mr. Anton is a futurist, lovely profession, no? Futurist. He predicts the future, looking at the past and the future trends, he predicts future. He's a, I think, a European guy, I don't know, a German or something. So I interact with him, so he told me a lot of things. I just using one of his predictions for you. That in the world that is coming, what are the six areas that will create a huge employment, or where the most growth will come in, which are the sectors, okay? What is the first sector? Tourism, okay? Tourism is about, is no more about what my father used to take me in once in a year in a vacation, summer holiday in school, family ke sath picnic jao. It's no more like that. Tourism and the world of, it's become more a part of life. All of you are living in cities. I'm assuming most of you have come from city background. We are all living in houses, in nuclear families, heavy pressure, a lot of traffic. The only break that people have is tourism. It's no more, it's tourism maybe with parents, but also with friends, with your partner, with special groups. There are special hobby tourisms, medical tourism. There are certain, you have your travel buddies. Tourism has become going to be a, there'll be a lot of innovations around tourism. You might have your interest area in which you can build as the tourism as an industry overall. And it's becoming affordable, that's also important. It's becoming reachable, okay? So tourism is going to be one of the industries which will have a huge employment in the future. Second, of course, as it's quite predictable, is the world of technology. Anything, not I mind you, not routine technology. Okay, at one point of time, India used to produce a lot of IT coders. That job is not going to increase. There'll be AIs which will come and replace the coding job. But high-end technology will be there. So if you move, so people have to go into high-end technologies. Okay. A lot of people, I don't know, but when I go to IIMs, surprisingly, I don't know, 99% is engineer. And in no other profession, it seems, in bachelor degree. Everybody engineer ka ke MBA, 99%. But now people are not going to my MBA, sorry to say. But people are also looking at MS, doing M-Techs. They're also looking at going into specializing in it because high-tech technology will come back in a big way because physical and digital sign-up will come, which I talked about. So all that is another big industry, which you know. Third is entrepreneur, third box here. As you know, many among you, I don't need to tell you this, many of you don't have lifelong dreams of working. Many of you want to do some, gain some experience, gain some funding, start something. A lot of common in many engineering colleges today. And it's not only about youngsters. It's also about a lot of middle-aged guys like me, who are also sometimes, yeah, we are a little stuck because we have the inertia to move out of a very comfortable life, but entrepreneurship, because the jobs and the job world will be very specific and it will reduce, entrepreneurship will go up. You get me? You are very tired. Number four is healthcare. Okay? At least you know the sectors where the jobs will be helpful for you. Sectors, healthcare. When I say healthcare, it's not doctors. Huh? Not necessarily. Healthcare is a full universe. There is a, apart from India and some of the Southeast countries, the other half of the, and Africa, the other part of the world is becoming aging, aging population. So right from doctors to medical science, to pharmacology, to nursing, to elderly care, Medicare, medical insurance, this whole thing comprises the healthcare universe. So healthcare as a subject and as industry is going to be, will be the driving employment areas. Because what happens is when generation changes, some industries will face, some sectors will phase away, some sectors will add, right? If you see, I have not talked about banking so much. Okay, because I think that will reach a particular level of maturity, after that it will stabilize. Fifth is energy management, the industry which I represent. Why? Worldwide. Energy management is, consists of energy generation, energy storage, energy distribution. Why? Because population is growing, you need food, you need energy. And today our life is getting more and more dependent on energy. Isn't it? From the past. So much thing that we are doing by the help, because there is industrialization, there is modernization, hence energy. And energy management will be a big thing. It's not going to be just about coal, oil, or everything, solar, wind, everything. The whole industry of energy management, innovation around that. And again, when I talked about, like somebody said, doctor, when I said healthcare, energy management is not about making energy, it's also about optimizing energy. There'll be technology around that. There are many buildings which have sensors in lights. You walk in, the light comes, you walk out, the light. So management of tech energy is also a part of this industry. So that is another big thing. And last is, your industry, Professor Bala's industry. Education would be a very big, because need for education will grow with population. There'll be huge opportunities and innovations. Many years back, when you were a graduate, other than medical and engineering, used to only go for this stream, used to be the arts, commerce, and science, and at the most economics in some colleges. But today, even forget international, even Indian, in Delhi University offers maybe 17 choices. There are a lot of, again, there'll be synapses there. I'm told there's a graduation course in science and music. So there'll be proliferation of education as an industry, and it will require a huge amount of teachers, professors, new subject matter expertise. I am told that you are starting a course called analytics, right? So few years back, this was never a course. So now that there is a course, you need somebody to come and talk about it. You need an expertise to talk about to you what is analytics. So that's, that. This is, to me, the six future fuel, growth-fueling economies that will happen. Okay? And last part of my interaction with you is about, if all this is true, if all this is going to happen, all that digital and all that, you know, volatility, all those industries, what are the, as you as a young generation population, when you go into your professional lives or to make your life, what are the key capabilities that become very important for you to nurture in yourself? College can give you education. Your temperament you have to develop. Nobody else can. Okay? According to me, there are three areas which, with my working life, I have experienced. And when I look back into my life, the last 20 years, how it has been, And that's how I tried to connect. And that's how I came up with my three ideas of which are the capabilities that each, I would suggest that you, it will help you. So behavioral, okay? Not technical, knowledge, no. It's you as a person. And it is not just about job. It's also about your life, I feel. Not swimming. It's talking about not talking about swimming. It's talking about building expertise. Aap kuch bhi karo, aap kisi na kisi cheez mein apne expertise zarur banao. General management ka zindagi will slowly fade away. Even if you know how to make a good tattoo, be a best in making a good tattoo. People will pay you for that. Getting what I'm saying? It can be anything, but build a personalized expertise into something. Because that will help you command a price and a premium. Friend or foes, you have to have the emotional quotient to deal with to deal with relationships. Because whatever you do, you get the expertise, which is okay. But the second part is with the expertise to make it work for you, you will be needing a lot of interactivity with people. And maybe sometimes friends, sometimes opposition. But it's the ability as we grow in our temperament to deal with those relationships, because otherwise you can be very impatient. So that I think will be another capability over a period of time in this very volatile world. And third, according to me, it's very, very personal opinion. One needs to have the ability to tide over rough times, because it is immaturish to expect that I will do everything right and there will be no tough times. There will be tough times. There will be ups and downs. But it's about, and there will be so much of volatility, it is important to see through it, to stand firm and let the volatility pass away. Because the next, I guess, 20, 30 years, we'll see a lot of unpredictability. And it is important for you as a person to develop that capability to be stable and let the wind or to withstand that volatility and that pressure over a period of time. Because nothing will be like immediate click up, click down, or you know something like that. As I told you, these are purely my own interpretations and my way of looking at things, which I wanted to share. So that's about it. I guess I've finished the time. Thank you very much.
In today's era, when we talk about Paris climate change, and on the other hand, the government of India wants that from 2030, they're gonna be all 100% electrical vehicles will be in the market. And as we all know, India is an emerging market and it's a price sensitive market too. And Suzuki has already coming up with a lithium ion battery plants. And that too, and what's your take on Exide and the battery industry? How it will gonna be, change in the future?
Okay, see, I will, by principle, not talk about my own company.
Surely.
But I'll talk about the industry, okay? Because this is on a public forum, I'll not talk about Exide. But yes, as I told, energy is a sector that is going to grow because the population is growing and the world is getting more and more dependent on energy. Now, as I said, energy generation, energy storage, and energy distribution are the three wings of the entire energy management universe. We are, of course, in the energy storage business. The energy storage as a business has got a high growth opportunity because of two things. Because the fossil fuel is getting more limited or more costly, particularly for India, there will be a proliferation aided by government, public private partnerships with respect to alternate this thing, and plus all these green environment bodies and this, that, they're also pushing for clean energy and all that. So this industry is also, opportunity is coming. A lot of MNCs are eyeing India to come into this industry. And because the alternative energy, particularly wind and solar, is intermittent, right? You don't get sunlight throughout the day, you don't get wind throughout the day. So it needs to be stored. So storage as an industry will be there as a part of this overall industry goal. Now coming to your second question about EVs, see, I have a feeling that after this is something that the current BJP government is pushing. I think because of the election, there is a little bit of a slowness on this, but they're committed to, even a few days back, they have been pushing this EV thing. Post 2019, after the election, I guess this will get a push. What it is stuck is not the need for it. What there is an allied infrastructure that is required. Because if you have to travel across country, unless we have like China solar highways, it requires, like petrol pumps will require charging stations. Or your battery swapping stations, either a charging station or a swapping station. Now that, it's a chicken and egg. Who will come out first? First, whether this country should have 5 lakh EVs and then the charging station should come, or whether the charging station should come and then people will buy. You will not buy a EV, right? Because you don't have a charging station. Which will come up first? So I guess there will be a government intervention that will be coming on the way. It will start with more to do with public transport first, and then it will move into private. But this trend will come. As I said, nothing, as I told you, like when I was talking about digital and nothing, it's not that this will come, so that will vanish. It will not happen like that. E-commerce will come, so shops will vanish. It will not be like that. So there will be EVs, there will be a large part of IC vehicles. But yes, it will grow because both the lobbies are pushing. One is the need to reduce dependence on oil, the other is of the green lobby.
So Suzuki is coming with the lithium-ion batteries. Suzuki, Japanese company. Suzuki,
okay, yeah. Okay, yeah.
So do you see a threat from the Japanese company?
Suzuki is a Japanese company.
So do you see the threats from there and?
Oh, yes. Well, I mean, if it's a new industry, it's a threat and opportunity both, no? Nobody is making today in India. So they are starting, I guess you must have read, we are also starting the similar plan. But I think the industry has to first evolve, and there'll be opportunity for some years for a lot of players to grow. You know, it'll not be like immediately it'll be a matured market. So there'll be a growth. And automobile is a very huge industry by itself. But what disrupts today a normal car, if you open the bonnet, it will perhaps have 200 plus parts and accessories. EV may be having 20-30 parts. So suddenly there will be a disruption in the auto component economy. That will affect. But otherwise, I guess there will be many players who will be coming into this, and there will be for some time there will be space to grow for many players. Like any industry, till some consolidation happens. That's what I feel.
So, my question is on the same lines. You spoke about energy management. My question is, do you think we as a country are matured enough to handle a surge in non-conventional energy? Like, to take an example of non-conventional cars, does India have an appetite and finances for cars like Tesla, especially as cars like Reva had flopped because of non-existence of basic charging stations? So what is your take on that?
I just explained to him. Tesla is a high-end, which I don't know why Elon Musk is still not coming to India, but I'm assuming someday he will come. He's still not coming to India, but I'm assuming that there will be not always a Tesla. Every industry has its stratification. High-end product, middle-end product, low-end product. So there will be low-end products. Tata is investing in that. Many automobiles are going into that. As I said, there will be some government intervention into this whole charging or swapping infrastructure. And it will not only be charging. Even if the best technology will still take you half an hour to charge, you will not wait in a place with your car to half an hour to charge. There will be swapping systems. you know, you give your old thing, like the new fitted going is like that. You know, it's going to be like that. But if what makes us comfortable is a lot of positiveness is in the government in promoting this. Capability is not the issue. You know, I was seeing a picture of a city, of New York City in some where there were horse-ridden carriages. Within 10 years, that particular PPT was showing a picture of New York in 10 years back with horse-driven carriages, and 10 years later with all cars. And petrol pumps those days would be, I'm assuming, would be more difficult to build. So if that change can happen in 10 years, in today, converting the building infrastructure is not a, it's a matter of some policies, it's a matter of some partnerships. Some big guys are already planning it. I am not sharing names right now. But a lot of companies, a lot of Indian big groups are already getting into this because this is an opportunity.
Anun sir. So as you were talking about the job creation and future in the tourism, technology and energy sector, sir, but talking about the past and present, these sectors have always been remain in the creating new jobs. But as you say, in the future technology, we talk about AI and IoT, etc. So if the new technology will come, then the older technology will also get vanished from the market.
Sure.
So sir, how will these job will create in the management sector and all? Because just like the computers came, and then after the mobile phones came, then the computer market, it's quite diminishing. The market value also decreases. So after the AI and IoT, how will that, the jobs will be created in the management sector and all?
See, partly you have answered your own question. I talked about those six industries which I told that futurist Mr. Anton has talked about. Medical, education, entrepreneurism, tourism, healthcare, and technology. But within that, generation might change. So something will go away, something will come, but that sector will have a lot of growth because that's what he's predicting. Like education, for example. Coming up, you know, new institutes, new subjects are coming up, so that will require more teachers, more kind of skills. While many of the very traditional setups might close down, like you are asking. But if 10 close down, 100 more will come up with new options, new streams. So that's a trend, and that's why he believes that industry, that if education is an industry, that industry will have a huge proliferation.
But sir, as AI and IoT will, the workforce will also decrease, no? The man force will decrease certainly because the...
Yeah, so it is comparative. Comparative to others, I told you the coding job might go to AI, but the interpretation job may not. Just to, you know, this whole thing about digitalization, because we are in this another conference when you're talking about this driverless car, so this person was demonstrating, he came from, to us, because we are part of the industry. There are many cameras, you know how it operates, right? Technology, there is a lot of camera which takes multiple pictures in a millisecond, which is like a driver's eye. And that does an algorithm and tells you the concept of space, distance, and the car moves. But if it is at a speed, and suppose there is a dog in front, okay, that algorithm will not be able to take a decision whether you save the dog or bang the car. There a human judgment comes. The machine can't decide that. So there will be still, I'm sure, a lot of opportunities where interpretive reasoning will be required rather than logical reasoning.
Thank you, sir. Your aura has lent a unique charm to the occasion, and the way you have taken us through various strategies to get customers enticed towards a product is surely enriching. We will surely inculcate your teachings.